Hello, greetings in Christ, and welcome to this, our second virtual worship service being taped at Holy Spirit of Peace in our beloved sanctuary on Friday, just before the Sunday that we are going to be gathering virtually. I am so pleased that you are able to join us for this service. I really wish we could be together physically, but if not, at least we can be together through this medium that allows us to gather in prayer and praise and worship, to hear scripture together and to ponder it as a community. So thank you for taking the time to be with us. Everything that you need for worship you will find in your bulletin, which has been emailed to you as a PDF and is also available on our website. So I invite you to take a moment to quiet your hearts and minds and let us begin our service. We begin with our order for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who is present, who gives life, who calls into existence the things that do not exist. Amen. If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand? Yet with you is forgiveness, and so we confess. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned away from you, knowingly and unknowingly. We have wandered from your resurrection life. We have strayed from your love for all people. Turn us back to you, O God. Give us new hearts and right spirits, that we may find what is pleasing to you and dwell in your house forever. Amen. Receive good news. God turns to you in love. I will put my spirit in you, and you shall live, says our God. All your sin is forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ, who is the free and abounding gift of God's grace for you. Amen. Let us lift our voices together in praise and worship in our gathering hymn, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing.
Thank you.
and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
I invite you to join in reading responsively our Psalm of the Day, Psalm 130. out of the depths, I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand? Yet with you is forgiveness, in order that you may be feared. I wait for you, O Lord, my soul waits.
In your word is my hope.
My soul waits for the Lord more than those who keep watch for the morning.
More than those who keep watch for the morning.
O Israel, wait for the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love.
With the Lord there is plenteous redemption.
For the Lord shall redeem Israel from all their sins.
The second reading is from Romans chapter 8. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies, also through his Spirit that dwells in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus. Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble, because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble, because the light is not in them. After saying this, he told them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right. Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Thomas said to his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. When Jesus arrived, he He found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now, Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her, because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer.
Well, siblings in Christ, another week and another set of messages that once again somehow seem to be incredibly, especially relevant for us in these challenging times. Our Hebrew scripture passage and our passage from John's Gospel both speak to us of death and, importantly, also of life. Life in a place where all we can see is death. Life in a place where life seems impossible. Life that only God can give. In a passage from Ezekiel, we hear about a desert filled with dry bones. Dry, parched, thoroughly lifeless bones. I'm sure you don't have to think very hard to imagine some places and situations in our lives today that call to mind this image of desolation and death and nothing but dry bones. Some of them are quite benign and trivial. I, as a baseball fan, am thinking of all of those pictures that we've seen recently of empty stadiums everywhere. At a time where we're supposed to be seeing opening day and subsequent days, this opening day weekend of baseball returning to our lives. For many of us, part of the rhythm of our lives is getting back to baseball. We've seen pictures of empty shopping centers, empty streets, beautiful public spaces that are known the world around that are all of a sudden completely desolate. The area around the Arc de Triomphe, the area around Trafalgar Square, the area around Times Square in New York, closer to home. So many places that have been left completely desolate. And even more poignantly and emotionally, we look at lineups of funeral cars waiting to bring bodies to cemeteries that simply cannot keep up with the need to bury. We see hospitals filled to the brim. Today I heard a story of a hospital that is even trying to share ventilators now that the supply of them has become so miserably insufficient. We see pictures of arenas or other public areas that have been converted into COVID testing centers, filled with row upon row of chairs in which are seated people who are sick and scared. Dry bones everywhere. But God has a word, a prophecy for Ezekiel about those dry bones. He tells Ezekiel to prophesy to them. He asks Ezekiel if those bones can live, and Ezekiel quite wisely and correctly answers, "O Lord, you know." Because the truth is, God does know, and we can't. But God tells Ezekiel to prophesy to those bones, to tell them to live, to join to one another, for sinew to join to sinew, for flesh to come on them. And we hear in the story that happens. Beyond our belief, beyond our understanding, new life comes in a place of dryness and isolation and death and deprivation. And breath comes into those bones too. The breath of God, the Holy Spirit, breathes into them at Ezekiel's command because God told it. Such an encouraging story. As we question, I am sure you do, I know I do, how can these bones live? How will we come through this pandemic that is so profoundly impactful for both those who are ill and those who are not? I think it's hard to imagine that anyone's life has not in some way been made drier by what is happening right now. And so even if you are one of those fortunate enough to not feel a direct impact from this illness, I am sure just the isolation, the loneliness, the sense of distance from one another, even that is drying. That is deprivation. And so even for those of us who are that fortunate, God's words to Ezekiel, the prophecy he calls on Ezekiel to deliver, speaks directly to our hearts and our minds in this day of pandemic as well. These dry bones can live. We see in our gospel for today as well the same sense of new life coming from a place where all we see is death. Jesus' beloved friend, Lazarus, is dying. And he knows Lazarus is dying, and yet he does not go immediately. We question that. We wonder how Jesus could not feel that sense of urgency. But perhaps that's because our understanding of death as final is different from Jesus, who recognizes that the human death that Lazarus will face, a death, let's not forget, that each one of us at one point will also face, though I pray not soon for any of us. But that death is inevitable, but it's not final. Jesus knows that. And so when he does journey to Judea, a dangerous journey, as his disciples point out, he is threatened. There is a price on his head, and he is going to be captured and killed if he goes anywhere near those authorities. The disciples know it, and so does Jesus. But he goes anyway, because there is work to be done. Notwithstanding Lazarus' death, Jesus has healing to do, has raising to do. Martha and Mary, Lazarus' sisters, and also beloved friends of Christ, we've met them in other stories before, they are trying to come to grips with what has happened. We're not surprised to learn that Martha, the practical, pragmatic, work in the kitchen all day one, is the one who first goes to Jesus. She abandons mourning and goes to confront him. And where we might expect her to be bitter and angry that Jesus did not come and save her brother, she does express her sadness about that, but moves from that to a place of trust and confidence and faith, identifying that she knows that he will rise with the resurrection, and she knows that Jesus is the Messiah, and that she trusts that all will be well. She then goes and calls for Mary to come, and Mary, the one who knelt at Jesus' feet, kneels there again, weeping. So sad at the loss of her brother. And she's followed by the mourners who join her in weeping. Rather a lovely tradition of the early times, and one that is still followed by many cultures in our world today, that mourners come specifically to weep with the family so that they won't be alone. Mary, too, shares her grief with Jesus, and expresses her, perhaps, confusion that he did not come and save her brother. But again, Jesus offers comfort and assurance that all will be well. He is brought to the tomb, where Lazarus has been for 4 days now. And again, Martha, the practical one, when he calls for the stone to be moved, begs him not to, saying, "Jesus, please, there's already a stench. He's been dead 4 days." She can't yet grasp what Jesus is about to do. But ultimately the stone is rolled away. And with a simple command, "Lazarus, come out," Jesus proclaims that death does not have the final word. Lazarus comes out of that tomb where he's been for 4 days, dressed as one would be as a dead man, wrapped in cloth, his hands and his feet bound, his face bound. And at this point, Jesus invites the mourners into the work of new life. He tells them to unbind Lazarus, to let him go. What an amazing story. And again, how appropriate for this time and this place. Jesus shows us, just as God showed Ezekiel, that God is able to do everything. That human death, the end of this life, is not the end for us. That we are called to new life and new beginnings that go far beyond anything that we can comprehend. But despite the fact that we can't understand what is happening, Jesus invites us into the work of this new life, for us to help to unbind those who have faced death whether it be the true human ending of life or simply times of darkness, of desolation, like Ezekiel faced. Jesus invites us into new life, but he also invites us to help one another, to lift one another up, and to unbind each other from those deathly frights and anxieties and concerns that weigh us down and make us feel less than fully alive. Let us take heart that God truly does know what is happening, even if we don't. That dry bones can be brought again to life, whether it be this human life or life beyond all our understandings. And let us accept Christ's invitation to reach out to one another, especially in this time, to unbind each other and give each other hope and strength and courage. May it be so among us. Amen. I commend to you at this time as well the questions for reflection and discussion, which I have included once again in our bulletin for this week. These are provided to us by the good people at workingpreacher.org, an outlet of Luther Seminary in St. Paul, Minnesota. I invite you either silently on your own in reflection, perhaps with some journaling, or in discussion with your loved ones who are gathered with you for this worship, to consider these questions, which I'll read for you now. Whose death have you wept over or grieved deeply? When was a time you felt God breathing new life into you? What is foremost on your mind when you pray these days? And finally, how do you perceive the presence, work, or impact of the Spirit in any given moment? I encourage you to consider those. And we'll continue our worship now with singing our hymn of the day, You Are Mine.
I will come to you in the soul.
life into every dry bone. Let us boldly confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess the faith of our baptism as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We will continue our worship now with the prayers of the people, using once again the intercessory prayer in the midst of the spread of COVID-19, a prayer resource generously created for all the world by the Lutheran World Federation.
O God, our healer, show your compassion for the whole human family that is in turmoil and burdened with illness and with fear. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Come to our aid as the coronavirus spreads globally. Heal those who are sick. Support and protect their families and friends from being infected. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Grant us your spirit of love and self-discipline, so that we may come together, working to control and eliminate the coronavirus. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Make us vigilant, attentive, and proactive in the eradication of all diseases, malaria, dengue, HIV, and AIDS, and others, that create suffering and often result in death for many people. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Heal our self-centeredness and indifference that makes us worry only when the virus threatens us. Open ways beyond timidity and fear that too easily ignore our neighbor. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Strengthen and encourage those in public health services and in the medical profession, caregivers, nurses, attendants, doctors, all who commit themselves to caring for the sick and their families. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Inspire. Give insight and hope to all researchers focused on developing a vaccine. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Sustain all workers and business owners who suffer loss of livelihood due to shutdowns, quarantines, closed borders, and other restrictions. Protect and guard all those who must travel. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Guide the leaders of the nations that they speak the truth, halt the spread of misinformation, and act with justice so that all your family may know you. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Heal our world, heal our bodies, strengthen our hearts and our minds, and in the midst of turmoil, give us hope and peace. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Hold in your gentle embrace all who have died and all who will die this day. Comfort their loved ones in their despair. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Remember all your family, the entire human race, and all your creation in your love.
Amen.
Let us join now in our thanksgiving for the word. O God of justice and love, we give thanks to you that you illumine our way through life with the words of your Son. Give us the light we need, awaken us to the needs of others, and at the end bring all the world to your feast. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen. And now, gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God, from generation to generation, in the Church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us lift our voices once more in this service together virtually by singing, God, my hope on you is found.
Thank you.
you.
The Lord's face shine on you with goodness and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God. Thank you all for being with us today for this service. I give thanks to God for every one of you and hold you all in my prayers. Stay safe, be well, and God bless you.